I welcome all those who are worshiping with us today on Facebook, wherever you are. We welcome you and we are glad you're here with us. The Lord will attend to every issue that you present to him today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And in order not to waste your time, let us go straight to what the Lord would like us to discuss today. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. It is good to praise the Lord, hallelujah. It is good to praise the Lord, hallelujah. It is good to praise the Lord, hallelujah, praise the Lord, hallelujah, praise the Lord, hallelujah. This morning, we want to discuss, because I like it, discussional, conversational kind of preaching. And what we want, the topic today is, how much is the kingdom of heaven worth to you? How much is the kingdom of heaven worth to you? Our Bible reading is taken from Matthew 13, 44 to 51. Matthew 13, 44 to 51. Amen. Amen. Matthew 13, 44 to 51.
Matthew 13, 44 to 51, right?
Yes.
Matthew 13, verses 44 to 51. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but threw the bad away. So it will be at the end of the age, the angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just, and cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Jesus said to them, have you understood all these things? They said to him, yes, Lord. Then he said to them, therefore, scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things new and old. Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Our memory verse is taken from verse 44 of that same chapter 13 of Matthew. And it says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure. Let me take that again. The kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man had found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he had, and buyeth that field. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure found in a field. When a man finds it, with joy, that he has discovered this treasure, goes away. He hides that treasure and then goes away and sell everything that he has, everything. Gathered the proceeds of all that and invest in one thing, the treasure of the kingdom of heaven. In our present day practice of finance, I have a finance background. They will call that a risky investment. Too risky. How can you take everything, all your eggs in one basket? That's not wise. That is what the world will tell you. They will tell you to hedge here. They will tell you to be conservative there. They will tell you, okay, put some in a savings account or put them in a very conservative investment so that you will not stand the risk of losing everything if something goes wrong. Well, in the world, that's very, very, very sound counsel, which we all did in the days when we practiced financial management and investment counseling and advice. But the Bible says something different. He said the man found it and went and sold everything, liquidated and turned everything probably to cash and take all of them to buy just one thing. What do you think about this? As children of God, you know, we walk by faith. Is your faith actionable? How much do you trust God? The Bible tells us that they that come to God must believe that He is, and He is a rewarder of them who diligently seek Him. Have we been in the world so much that they influence the way we think without our really realizing that that is the case? God has not called us to emulate and follow the counsel of the world, but to show the world true wisdom. True wisdom. There are things we have to do in the world, to live in the world, to operate in the world. But the fundamental values that guide our decision must not be of the world. It must come from the kingdom to which we belong, that overrides ultimately the things that occur and happen in the world. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave, out of his love, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." For God to give his only begotten Son because of his love for you is because he does not want you to perish. That if you do not believe in him, you will perish. There's no two ways about it. And because he does not want you to perish, he loves you. He gave you a solution. Something that will keep you from perishing. His only begotten Son. Hello. Because of the love of God, because of the love God has for you. Amen. His thoughts for you are always for peace and not of evil. That's written in Jeremiah 29:11. Because he loves you. That same love made him give his only begotten Son, his all, his only begotten Son, his all to you, so that you can have a leverage, you can have an opportunity, you can have power, you can have an avenue, a way of cheating death, of not perishing, of having eternal life. He wants you to come into eternal life because he loves you. He cares for you. He wants the best for you. And in that Jeremiah 29:11, he said, the thought that he has for you is for peace and not for evil. You see how God's love keeps flowing. You can find in every area of the Bible, the love of God, the central theme of God towards you is love. Amen? So he said, because he loves you and he wants the best for you, he's thinking a positive, lively thought towards you, a thought that is for peace and not for evil. He has taken you by the hand and is leading you to an expected end of peace and not for evil. Amen? Because of this love, he wants the best for you and counseled you to choose life and not death in Deuteronomy 30:19. You see, God will not leave anything to chance concerning you because he loves you that much. He wants to save you. He wants the best for you. He does not want you to be under the power of evil, but he wants you to be in peace. Amen? Hallelujah. So in Deuteronomy, he went on to give more instruction, more guidance for the avoidance of confusion, for the avoidance of misunderstanding, for the avoidance of mistake, and you making the wrong choice. He says in Deuteronomy 13:19, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your seed may live. Powerful. He did not leave anything to any chance of you making the wrong choice. We know that God, he made everything, both good and bad, both curses and blessings, both peace and evil. He is the one who makes the iron and even the smith, iron smith, who fashioned the weapons. But at the same time, he says, no weapon that is fashioned against you will prosper because of his love for you. He is the one who creates life and death. But he said to you, my desire for you, because of my love for you, is to choose life. Amen? This life is found in the kingdom of heaven only. The life that the Lord is asking you to choose is the one that is found in the kingdom of heaven. Only in the kingdom of heaven. That is eternal life, and this by and through his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you must believe to attain and to take hold of this eternal life. The desire of God for you. The love of God for you. The gift of God for you. Eternal life that is found in Christ Jesus. Only by those who believe in his name. The ultimate sacrifice, payment that God has made for your soul and for my soul. Amen. Yes, this life is found in his Son, Jesus Christ. Because he loves you and has good thoughts for you, he advised you to seek the kingdom of heaven first above all other things. Ah, That is found in Matthew 6, 33. Seeking the kingdom of God first. Before you begin to seek any other thing and every other thing, seek that first. Settle that matter. For that is what he wants for you. And he wants the best for you. Therefore, whatever counsel he gives to you will flow out of that love for you that wants the best for you. And he went on to say to you, choose life. Choose it first. Choose that place where life is talking about is, can be found, that is obtainable, the kingdom of heaven. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and the righteousness of that kingdom. And every other thing shall be added unto you. The one who loves you. The one who does not want to see you suffer. The one who does not want to see you live in misery, in condemnation, in fear, in evil, says, choose the kingdom of heaven first. Do you know what? He does not want you to make the mistake that Adam made. God does not want you to make the mistake Adam made in Genesis. Adam had the tree of life available and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He chose first the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and missed out on the tree of life. By choosing the tree of good and the knowledge of good and evil, he lost everything. If he had chosen the tree of life, he would have gained everything because God would have added to him every other thing, just as he promised in the book of Matthew, where he revealed that secret. And today God is asking you, how much do you value the kingdom of heaven? What portion of the effort you put out every day do you attach to pursuing first the kingdom of heaven? Hallelujah. The kingdom of heaven is available and obtainable for those who will seek it. The Lord said in John 10:10 that he has come. He came to give you life in abundance. You see, the interest of God is your own welfare and well-being. In any way you turn it and consider it, he wants you to prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Everywhere you look, God loves you. He loves the world. He created the world. He made the world for his pleasure. He wants to enjoy your fellowship, your company. He wants to enjoy you. He wants things to be good for you, to be easy for you, not in confusion and suffering and death and misery. Something has gone wrong. Adam made a wrong choice. Instead of choosing life, he chose the knowledge of good and evil, and he lost everything. But God saying, I have sent my son, my only begotten son. You know, when you look at these things, you begin to receive some revelations. If you go to the genealogy, and creation. You will see that the Bible says, Adam, the son of God. You know, that was Adam, was also the son of God. But when you consider Jesus, the Bible said, the only begotten. You see the difference there? The Son of God became the Son of God because God poured his Spirit upon him, but he was formed out of the dust. So he had weaknesses that came from being part of the dust. Now, I want you to know something. The dust does not give up dust. The dust, the earth is so selfish that it will not give up anything. Adam became a victim of the selfishness of the dust, which is the earth. That is why you see this gravity. Anything that wants to leave the gravitational sphere of the earth tries to pull it down back to itself. Doesn't want it to go. You have to overwhelm and overpower it to escape into the outer space. Adam became a victim and he fell because he was dust. It says, from dust you are made and dust you return. Look at the contrast with Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, not of dust. Because of that, he had power over sin and he overcame sin and never sinned. And the Lord now says, you were born from the image of Adam, so you are dust. But I have sent my only begotten Son to come and rescue you if you will believe in him. If you believe in him, you will not perish. The dust, the earth shall not consume you. He will rescue you from that death. And you will live eternally. Where everything is perfect, there is perfection eternally, not the imperfection of the earth. That's why Jesus Christ came and said, I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. He came to give you abundant life, life that is free from oppression. He came that you might live and live eternally. But first of all, you have to seek that kingdom. The kingdom that Jesus Christ represents. Right now, we are at a dispensation and a time where you have the two kingdoms existing side by side. Just like in the church today, you have tares existing side by side with the seed of God in the same church. Until the fullness of time, when the Lord said, I will send my angels to go and harvest, gather the tares and burn them away in hell, everlasting fire, and collect my seed for the kingdom, existence, and experience. The scriptures agree together all the time. All you need to have is a revelation of what the scripture is saying. Not to take one side and run with it and not understand what it's saying. So the kingdom of heaven is available and obtainable for those who will seek it. The Lord said in John 10:10 that I've come to give you abundant life. Amen. This abundant life is not the type that you have. Think of the kind of life that you have in the world. He gives not the one that the world gives. You know, Jesus has always made that difference between the dual existence that you have today, the world and his kingdom. He said, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives, do I give. So whatever the world will give to you is contrary to what the Lord will give to you, Jesus Christ will give to you. Because they represent two different kingdoms. We are physically in the kingdom of the world and spiritually in the kingdom of heaven. For the Bible says we are seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, while he sent his spirit to live with us, inside us, in the kingdom of this world. Amen. So when whatever God gives to you, whatever the Lord is giving to you, is different from what the world will give to you. The world will like to copy what Jesus will give, but falls short. And that is what is deceiving the whole world. The world will pursue what the world will give. People will pursue what the world will give. But few will be wise enough to pursue what Christ will give. And Christ gives that counsel. Seek the kingdom of heaven, not the kingdom of the world. Because in the kingdom of heaven is life, eternal life. Seek that first. Conquer that. Take hold of it. Possess it. Then you will be established. Amen. This life is available to those who believe in his name and will confess the same by calling on him and seeking him, as advised in Jeremiah 29:12-14. Jeremiah 29:12-14 is advising you on how to seek this kingdom. And it says, then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me, when ye shall search for me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, saith the Lord. He said, you will call upon me. You have to seek me with all your heart. Not partially. If you want this kingdom of heaven, if you want to take hold of it and possess it, as a first wise decision and action you take, you have to do it with all that you have. All your heart. Because when God sent his son, he sent his only begotten son, only one, all that he has. He set him forth as propitiation. He set him forth as antidote to sin. He set him forth to be the only way available under heaven by which a man can be saved and find the kingdom of heaven. He gave his all. So for you to find that kingdom of heaven, you have to seek him. You have to ask him. You have to pray for him, to him. You have to cry unto him. You have to do it with everything that you have, that you are, that you can be. All power, all might that you have. That is how you can seek and find him. That's why he says here, then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me. You call upon him, you go and pray unto him. And ye shall seek me and find me. This is the condition. Ye shall seek me and find me, when ye shall search for me with all your heart. Not sitting on the fence. One side is trying to get to the kingdom of heaven, and the other side is in the world, thinking that you're wise. You know, some people will say, this is your Christianity. You better practice it with wisdom. They are talking about worldly wisdom. When the Bible is talking about faith, For the only way you can win this war against in the world is to fight the good fight of faith. And with faith, you conquer everything. But the world is advising you, be careful. Look at that investment. Don't put all your eggs in one basket, for you risk losing everything. That's the world. In their sector, in their thoughts, in their worldly mindset, they are correct and it works for them. But it's only temporary. Amen. He said, when you seek me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, said the Lord. That's the condition. Remember, the Bible says that with your heart you believe unto righteousness, and with your mouth you confess. Amen. Romans 10:9-10. You believe in your heart. You confess with your mouth. And this here, the Lord is saying, and ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. Believe with your heart. Amen. And I will be found of you, said the Lord. It's not just come and say, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and then you are born again, which is what some people have preached and are preaching, and there are so many people in church that are not in Christ. Because they have not emphasized the fact that you have to believe with all your heart, no doubt whatsoever. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sakolina mama mama makushinda. Amen. It said, and I will be found of you. Amen. Let us move on. There are so many things to discuss here. The question here is, what value do you think the kingdom of heaven is worth to you? How much is it worth to you? What value have you attached to it? What price are you? Or how much do you really want what God wants for you? God wants you to seek the kingdom of God and take hold of it and possess it. How much do you want it for yourself? Do you trust Him to be correct for you? That what He is asking you to do is the best for you? How much do you really want what God wants for you? What price are you ready to pay to take hold of the kingdom of heaven? That's a personal question. What price are you ready to pay? Jesus Christ came and laid down His life. God gave all His very best, all He has. And Jesus Christ came and laid it down and did not withhold His blood from His life. He poured it out. How much do you value that? What do you think is the right value that you have for that which God has done and called you to? How much are you ready to pay to take hold of the best God has offered? It is easy to be busy and running around and seeking the things of this temporary things of this world and ignore and fail to realize that the wise thing to do, prudent thing to do, is to heed the counsel of God. Hallelujah. What price are you ready to pay to take hold of the kingdom of heaven? Remember, God gave His only begotten Son to make the kingdom of heaven available for you. In other words, He gave His all. What are you ready to give up for the kingdom of heaven? Or put it differently, what has reaching for the kingdom of heaven cost you? What have you given up in exchange for the kingdom of heaven? God gave up his son. His son gave up his life. And he said, if you come to me, call upon me, pray into me, seeking me with all your heart, seeking me with all your heart, he said, I will reveal myself to you. You will find me. And where you find me, you'll find the kingdom of heaven. For the knowledge of God, by his revelation, is eternal life, the Bible says. In your seeking to be a Christian, in your walk as a Christian, have you withheld anything? Something you will not let go. Because you're in the world. And as you convert to the kingdom of heaven, is there anything you're withholding? Something you cannot give up? Because if there's such a thing, you're not seeking God with all your heart. If there is such a thing, you have not received the kingdom of heaven. You have not found it yet. There may be someone who has offended you, wronged you, and you have every right to be angry, but you have not forgiven that person. The Bible says you do not forgive them. Your Father in heaven will not forgive you. You are holding that unforgiveness. You are not letting it go so that you can enjoy access to the kingdom of heaven. I've always said that do not allow money or financial issues be a source of quarrel between me and anybody. If you cheat me out of money and all those things, if I ask you, you refuse to give to me, I'll let you go. I'll not keep pursuing you. If you offend me, I tell you, you have offended me, and you refuse to apologize or repent, go. Nothing can stand between me and the kingdom of heaven. For that is not the plan of God for my life. Whatever it will cost to gain that kingdom, I'm ready to pay the price. Because the possession of the kingdom of heaven is the possession of life. And it is the possession of everything. Not just life, temporal in this world, but eternal. The children of God are those who have possessed and taken hold of the kingdom of heaven. Not those, the tares in the temple, the tares in the church, who are always jumping all over the place and trying to use many words, loudness and noise to convince themselves that they are already in the kingdom. That is not the scripture. The kingdom of God will cost you something. In fact, it will cost you everything. That's why when we talk about the kingdom, we talk about giving your life to Christ. Giving your life to Christ, not withholding any. Even physically in your body, say, present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. Approved of God, for this is your reasonable service. So when you come to Jesus, you come with everything. Everything. What has it cost you? Are you being wise and a manager, trying to balance this and balance that? That is not a scripture. Let me continue. Hallelujah. What has reaching for the kingdom of heaven cost you? It has to cost you something. In fact, everything. What is the opportunity cost to you? What is the opportunity? What have you exchanged for the kingdom? You don't put new wine in old bag. Or old wine in new bag, mixing everything. No. You have to discard the old for the new to stand. The new old covenant discarded. The new covenant stands. That's the way of the kingdom by Christ Jesus, the last Adam, the second man, who is spiritual. If you look at that 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Bible says the first Adam was earthly. He was from the earth. But the last Adam is spirit from above. Contrasting. Though they were both called sons of God, one was not begotten of God. One was formed by God. The second man, the last Adam, was begotten. A stark difference. One was formed, one was begotten. The one that was formed had his weaknesses. The one that was begotten is God Almighty. Hallelujah. That's another issue. Amen. Hallelujah. In the parables of Jesus in Matthew chapter 13, our Bible reading for today, verses 44 to 46 says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man had found, he hid it, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he had and buyeth the field. He went on to say, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. You see, in those two illustrations, this man found something that is great. Something that is priceless. Something they highly valued. And what did the first man do? He hides this thing he found so that he can go. He didn't tell anybody he found anything. So that he can go raise the fund that is needed to buy that, to buy the field. If he had disclosed it, people who have much more money, who can easily buy it, will go because they have money, they will go and buy it. But he was wise enough to say, I'm concealing this, the kingdom of heaven in my heart, until I am able to enter. He took everything he had, liquidated everything, turned everything into cash, and went and bought one land. He must have had big properties, but he sold everything and had just one thing, enough to buy that land, because the value he placed upon that land was greater than every other thing he had. In the second instance, a pearl. We know what a pearl is. Of great value. This man found it. One pearl could be stolen from him. He could lose it. But he didn't mind. He went and sold everything he had. Everything. And bought just one pearl. Of great value. How much is the kingdom of God? What's the lead? What have you sold? What are you protecting at the expense of seeking the kingdom of heaven first? When God, if you believe him, already promised you, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because that is where eternal life is. He placed before you because I love you. My thought for you is for peace and not for evil. I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. Today, I call heaven to be a witness between you and I, God says. I place before you curses and blessings. I place before you life and death. And I say to you, choose life. As a loving father who wants the best for you, I say choose life. Because that is where I'm taking you. Investing your all into the kingdom of heaven is a wise decision. Because it is an investment decision that cannot fail. It cannot fail. Investing in the kingdom of heaven with your life cannot fail. The wisest and greatest decision that you will ever make. It is an investment decision that cannot fail. It is an investing choice that will bring returns that will cover and include other things you seek and desire. You see, Adam chose something contrary to life and lost everything. And God is asking you, choose life. Choose the kingdom of heaven first. And included in that choice is everything that you will ever need or desire. He said, all things will be added to it unto you. When you choose the kingdom of heaven, and you take hold of the kingdom of heaven, every other issues in your life, God will mitigate. God will come and solve them. Are you sick? When you come into the kingdom of heaven, your bread is healing. For the bread, what you're asking is the bread of the children. And you will not take that which belongs to the children and cast them to the dogs. So if you are sick in your body, you want God to heal you. You want to gain health. When he says, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health. What do? Seek the kingdom of heaven first. If you are in poverty, seek the kingdom of heaven first. You are looking for marriage. You are looking for children. You are looking for career excellence. Seek the kingdom of heaven first. Invest in the right place, in the right thing. When you do that, all other things will be added to you. Amen. God knows why he says, seek ye the kingdom first. Do you know why? It is because where you find the kingdom of heaven first, all other things will be added to you. You will no longer continue to labor for other things that the world labor for, because they shall be added to you with the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Remember how the Bible says in the book of Hebrews, there remaineth a rest for the people of God. It's a labor to enter into this rest. How do you do that? Take hold of the kingdom of heaven. You think about it. Is your faith expressible? Is your faith what you should be? Are you believing God the way you ought to? Seek you first the kingdom of heaven. Look at your life and examine yourself, for the Bible commands us to examine ourselves to see if we are still in faith. Is there anything you're withholding from God? Is there a sin you are clinging to? Is there something that you know you have had witness of the Holy Spirit? Give it up. But you are still holding on to it because of fear, insecurity. Such things are holding you back from the full experience of the kingdom of heaven. Will you seek God today? Will you call upon him? Will you ask him? Will you come to seek him with all your heart? I remember those days when you come to seek God with all your heart. You come to answer the altar call or to invite Jesus into your heart. We wept tears. I know how many times I wept these tears. It must have been more than a dozen times. I will go out and be crying for the forgiveness of my sins, seeking God in truth and in verity with all my heart. But these days, how many people weep before the Lord for their souls to gain access to the kingdom that he gave with all that he has? If you come the right way today, the Bible says, will he not give you everything? Who gave you his son, his only begotten son? Will he not give you everything with him? Bow down your head and talk to him. Talk to the Lord. Is there anything that you have placed above the kingdom of heaven? Is there anything that you have placed at par with the kingdom of heaven? Those things will not help you. You have to place and value the kingdom of heaven above everything. And then you have to strive and labor to seek that kingdom, to take hold of it first and foremost. Then every other thing will be added to you. That's what the Lord is telling you this morning. I don't know where you're streaming with us in this worship service. God has spoken to you. I don't know what considerations that are inhibiting you from taking hold and having a full experience of the kingdom of heaven and the power that flows thereof. Give those things up right now. Call upon Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Call upon him who came and gave his all, that you might have this life abundantly. Call upon the only begotten Son of God and place the kingdom of heaven higher than every other consideration on this earth. Let us pray. Hallelujah. Talk to the Lord right now. Talk to the Lord. How much is the kingdom of heaven worth to you? Only you can answer that question. While you are doing this prayer right now, please take up your bread as usual and accompany this prayer as we come together in agreement before the table of the Lord. Hallelujah. Take up your bread. With thanksgiving, break it. Thank you, Lord. This is the body of Jesus Christ that was broken for us. And as we come together as one body, we eat in agreement. His bread, his body. But when you eat this, you bring healing to you, a physical body. To bring nourishment, to strengthen you. Right now, everywhere you have pain, sickness, your back, your head, migraine, headache, tumor, whatever it is, whatever it is, whatever it is, take this in remembrance of me. For by his stripes, you are healed. We use this as a point of contact for our sister's mother, Charlene's mother right now, that the Lord will send his word to her to heal her from the oppression of the enemy. In the mighty name of Jesus. Take it and eat it. In Jesus' name. In the same manner, after you have eaten, pick up your cup. The Lord said, just do remembrance of me. For this is the sign of the new covenant in my blood. Remember, the sign of the new covenant in the Spirit. As the only begotten Son, not formed, but begotten of the Father. This is his life that he poured out for you so that you can gain access into the kingdom of heaven and find eternal life and live forever. For Christ in you is the hope of glory. As we partake of this morning, we do it in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, in remembrance of him. Amen. Let's get together. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Just thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Wherever you are, every Sunday we do this. So next time, if you're not prepared today, be prepared. Have your cup with the grape juice in it and have a bread as part of his body. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen and amen. And God bless you.